You're watching Just the News and Faye D'Souza. We begin with an update on the terrible incident that has occurred in Nagaland. Now, over the weekend, 15 people, out of which 14 were unarmed civilians, were killed in Nagaland in a counter-insurgency operation of the Indian Armed Forces that has gone terribly wrong. According to the confirmation now delivered in Parliament by the Home Minister Amit Shah, Special Forces of the Indian Army were actually set for a counter-insurgency operation in Mon district that borders Myanmar after they received a tip-off that there would be some militants traveling in that area. Following that tip-off of the possible movement of insurgents, they laid an ambush near the Oting village on Saturday afternoon. They opened fire on a truck that was carrying civilian coal mine daily wage laborers. Six people in that truck died on the spot. Two were taken to the hospital, and from some newspaper reports in the Hindu and also in NDTV, they died in hospital. Following this incident, angry villagers surrounded the security forces, and the security forces opened fire on those villagers in self-defense. The army, in a statement, said, and I quote, "Based on credible intelligence of the likely movement of insurgents, a specific operation was planned to be conducted in the area of Tiru Mon district in Nagaland. The incident and its aftermath are deeply regretted," end quote. In Parliament today, the Union Home Minister Amit Shah said, and I'm quoting, "The army had received information about the movement of extremists in Oting in Mon. On that basis, 21 commandos laid an ambush in the suspected area. A vehicle reached there. It was signaled to stop, but it tried to flee. On suspicion of the vehicle carrying extremists, it was fired upon." The minister also added, and I'm quoting, "It was later found to be a case of mistaken identity. Two people who were injured were taken to the nearest health center by the army." Shah said that after receiving news of the incident, local villagers surrounded the army unit and set two vehicles on fire. During the violence, one soldier was killed and several others were injured, he said. Security forces had to resort to firing in self-defense to disperse the crowd. This caused the death of seven more civilians and some were injured, he informed Lok Sabha. The current situation is tense but under control. On December 5th, the Nagaland DGP and commissioner visited the site. An FIR has been registered, keeping the seriousness of the matter in mind. The probe was handed over to the State Crime Police Station, he said. The Home Minister also informed the House that an agitated crowd of about 250 people vandalized the company operating base of the Assam Rifles in Mon City on the 5th of December. The Assam Rifles had to open fire to disperse the crowd. This caused the death of one more civilian, the minister confirmed today. Lok Sabha members condemned the killing of civilians and demanded an impartial probe into the incident. Members also called for the repeal of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, enforced in Nagaland, that allows security personnel to use force and even open fire after due warning in case of breach of law and order. Several opposition parties, including the Congress, the DMK, the SP, BSP, NCP, walked out of the Lok Sabha after the Home Minister Amit Shah had delivered his statement. In the meantime, in Nagaland, which remains tense, public gathering of more than five people at a time has been banned in the Mon district. Movement of all vehicles which are non-essential has been stopped. All commercial vehicles, including commercial vehicles, it's been prohibited under Section 114 of the CRPC. The Nagaland government has ordered a high-level probe into the incident by a special investigating team. According to the Indian Express, a Suomoto FIR has been filed on Sunday by the officer in charge at the Thizhi police station that said the intention of the security forces was to murder and injure civilians. The situation in the district has been tense ever since the incident took place. The Nagaland chief minister tweeted, and I'm quoting the tweet, it said, "The unfortunate incident leading to the killing of civilians is highly condemnable. Condolences to the bereaved families and speedy recovery to those injured. High-level SIT will investigate and justice will be delivered." The Konya community, then, in the meantime, to which the villagers belonged, have said that they have decided to abstain from further participation of the Hornbill Festival. Six other tribal groups said they will not participate as well. There was a funeral that was held today for those deceased. In a statement, the BJP state unit chief, who's also the Minister of Tribal Affairs, pointed out that unarmed civilians were killed in the incident. He said it is therefore tantamount to war crimes during peacetime and amounts to a summary execution as well as genocide. He said they cannot be tolerated at any cost. Simply putting the blame on an intelligence failure is the lamest excuse. An update now on COVID and the movement of the Omicron virus in India. We have a total of 23 cases of the Omicron virus in India as of now. Maharashtra's tally has reached 10 out of those 23. The remaining cases are coming in from Jaipur, Rajasthan, which has reported 9 cases, Delhi 1, Gujarat 1, and Karnataka 2. Aviation Minister Jyotiraditya Scindia on Monday directed Delhi Airport Operator, DIAL, to implement better crowd management strategies after passengers complained of complete and utter chaos and large crowding at Delhi Airport's terminal following the implementation of the new coronavirus-related travel guidelines. Meanwhile, several state governments are taking preventive measures as well. The Delhi Chief Minister has asked the public not to panic and follow COVID-appropriate behavior. Tamil Nadu government has taken preventive measures, including door-to-door vaccination. Karnataka Chief Minister has said the state is fully prepared to control the new variant. Maharashtra's Deputy Chief Minister Ajit Pawar said that there is a need to take a decision at the national level on whether the booster dose of the vaccine is necessary to curb the pandemic. India reported 8,306 cases of COVID so far in the last 24 hours. In Karnataka, 35 students of a residential school in Narsimha Rajpura Taluk tested positive for COVID on Monday. With this, 94 students have tested positive for COVID altogether. Meanwhile, as many as 29 students tested positive for COVID in a nursing school in Karnataka's Shivamogga district. Most of the students, though, were asymptomatic, which is good news. According to ANI, Shivamogga Deputy Commissioner KB Shivkumar has said that we're doing random sampling at many places and found out that a few students who came from other states to this private nursing school had contracted COVID. We have sealed the hostel premises. Around 29 students have tested positive. 69 people, including 59 students in a school in Karnataka's Chikmagalur district, have tested positive for COVID as well. Now, in the middle of all of the concerns of the Omicron variant, the Karnataka Health Minister, Dr. K. Sudhakar, has said the state has instructed medical colleges across the state to make necessary preparations for every possibility. Remember, Karnataka has reported 2 cases of the Omicron variant so far. The Karnataka Primary and Secondary Education Minister, B.C. Nagesh, told the media that we will not backtrack if the need arises to stop exams and schools. However, in the present situation, all experts are of the opinion that there's no problem. If required, we will stop exams. However, the standard operating procedure is maintained very strictly in exams, and we are making arrangements to maintain physical distance, he said. 43 students in the Chalameda Anand Rao Institute of Medical Sciences in Telangana's Karimnagar district have tested positive for COVID this weekend, forcing authorities to shut the campus down. Authorities believe that the college event held last week, where many people were without masks, could have led to the outbreak. Telangana's public health director, Dr. G. Srinivas, has said he expects more COVID cases mid-January, with numbers peaking in February. Union Health Minister Mansukh Mandavia on Monday said 85% of India's eligible adult population have received at least one dose of the COVID vaccine so far. The cumulative vaccine doses administered in the country are now 127.9 crore doses. The minister said that 50% of Indian adults are fully vaccinated. The Supreme Court today lashed out at state governments of Maharashtra, West Bengal and Rajasthan for failing to provide compensation to the people who died of COVID. In October, remember, the Supreme Court had directed all state governments to give 50,000 rupees as compensation to families of COVID victims under the several center and state government schemes. The bench said, and I'm quoting here, "We are not happy at all with the affidavit filed by the Maharashtra government. Over 1 lakh deaths have been recorded in Maharashtra, but only 37,000 applications so far were received. Not a single person has been paid compensation yet. It is ridiculous and cannot be accepted," end quote. Sachin Patil, the lawyer representing the Maharashtra government, asked for more time. to start dispersing compensation and said he will file an affidavit. To this, Justice M.R. Shah warned strict action against the government and said, you keep that affidavit in the pocket and give it to your chief minister. The US and UK have announced new travel guidelines in light of the new variant. All incoming passengers into the US will have to carry a COVID negative test report taken within a day of travel. To the UK, the test will have to be taken within 2 days of travel. The rules are mandatory even if the person is fully vaccinated. Rules are applicable in the US from the 6th of December and the UK from the 7th of December. An update on Parliament. Rajya Sabha, according to a report we understand from NDTV, has lost 52% of its scheduled sitting time to protests and disruptions in the first week of the ongoing winter session. This comes after opposition leaders have been protesting the suspension of 12 MPs due to the unruly behaviour on the last day of the monsoon session. The opposition has called the suspension undemocratic and selective. On Friday, BJP leaders protested against the opposition's protest at the same spot in front of the Gandhi statue on the premises. Productivity of the House during the last week has been about 47%. President Vladimir Putin, who is visiting India, flagged the fight against terrorism, drug trafficking and organized crime as key challenges which both the countries will have to cooperate and expressed concerns about the situation in Afghanistan. The Russian president in his opening remarks said, and I quote, it is natural we're concerned about the development of the situation in Afghanistan. He called India a great power, a friendly country and a time-tested friend. Prime Minister Modi, in return, said, and I quote, despite the challenges posed by COVID, there is no change in the pace of growth of India and Russia relations. Our special privileged strategic partnership continues to be stronger. The Supreme Court today stayed the Maharashtra government's decision to bring an ordinance of 27% reservation of other backward classes without following the mandatory triple test in the state elections. In its order, the bench observed that without setting up a commission to collect data local government-wise, it is not open to the State Election Commission to provide a reservation in the OBC category. That is the first step which ought to have been done. This court also noted that in the order, the state government had brought an ordinance without following the triple test laid down by the Vikas Krishna Rao Wali versus the state of Maharashtra judgment regarding the reservation in local body elections. In March this year, the Supreme Court has struck down the Maharashtra state government's move to introduce 27% reservation for OBC in Zilla Parishad and Panchayats, saying it violates the 50% cap laid down by the Supreme Court's previous judgments. And in politics, Maharashtravadi Gomantak Party, a former ally of the BJP in Goa, has announced a pre-poll alliance with Mamata Banerjee's TMC for the upcoming elections. The head of the party has said details like who will be the chief ministerial face of this alliance will be worked out later. The MGP had actually won 3 seats out of a total 40 seats in the Goa Assembly. It's currently left with only one MLA because the remaining two switched over to the BJP in the previous term of government. Here's an update also from the world of business and economy. Nobel laureate Abhijit Banerjee has said people in India are in extreme pain and the economy is still way below the 2019 levels. Speaking at the Ahmedabad University's convocation ceremony, he went on to say, and I'm quoting, I just spent time in rural West Bengal. The stories you hear about, you know, all the aspirations that have been a little bit dashed are very real. Small aspirations have become smaller now. I think we are in a moment of great pain. The economy is still well below what it was in 2019. We don't know how much below, but it's substantially below. I'm not blaming anybody, I'm just saying, end quote. According to the Times of India, prices of tomatoes are recently reduced to 40 rupees per kg, have surged again and crossed the 100 rupees per kg mark in Madurai. According to the New Indian Express, in Chennai, the prices of tomatoes are now 90 rupees. Tamil Nadu and other southern states are already reeling under flood and the economic impact of COVID, which has added to the woes. Earlier, the Food and Consumer Affairs Ministry has said tomato arrivals in North Indian states will begin in December, which will add to the availability and lead to a fall in prices. Also, news coming in from across the world. In a joint statement, 22 countries, including the US, UK, EU, have called on the Taliban to end targeted killings of former members of Afghan security forces. This comes after a report was released that said that over 100 executions and abductions of former Afghan government officials have taken place since the Taliban took over in August this year. In a statement, the countries have said that all cases of extrajudicial killings and enforced disappearances will be fully investigated. The statement concluded by saying, "We will continue to measure the Taliban by its actions." In Myanmar, Nobel Prize winner and Myanmar's leader Aung San Suu Kyi has been sentenced to 4 years in prison by a court for breaking COVID rules. This is the first verdict among several other charges against Aung San Suu Kyi. Another verdict is expected next week. She's been accused of importing walkie-talkies in the country, inciting violence, and breaking COVID rules. Suu Kyi, who is 76, was Myanmar's state's counselor, de facto leader for the country before she was ousted and detained by the military 10 months ago. According to the advocacy group Assistance Association for Political Prisoners, more than 1,300 people have been killed by security forces in the country since the coup, and 10,000 people have been arrested. Quick update from sports as well. India shuttler PV Sindhu lost to South Korea's 19-year-old contender in the women's singles final at the BWF World Tour Finals in Indonesia. PV Sindhu will next be seen defending her world championship title in Spain. She had won that title in 2018 to become the only Indian to have achieved that feat. And a piece of positive news before we leave you for today. In West Bengal, a lady called Papia Khar has won everyone's heart on the internet after a picture of her sharing and serving the wedding meal from her brother's wedding went viral. She took the food to a railway station and served it personally to the hungry people who were there while still wearing her wedding outfit. As the wedding season now comes in case you or your family members are getting married, remember, you can get in touch with NGOs like the Robin Hood Army or Feeding India, who will come to the venue, pick up the leftover food and distribute it among the hungry people in your city. Both of these organizations are easily contactable on the internet. That brings us to the end of the news. Thank you so much for watching. Do leave us a word of encouragement or a thumbs up in the comment section if you find this news helpful. Good night.